listened about it already. We live in a world of constant change. And if I have to define what we've seen on the screen, all those changes, I think there's a good word that summarizes it. It's innovation. So that's what we're going to talk today about innovation. So my name is Raquel Rodrigo, and together with my colleague Simone Pancaldi, we're going to talk about innovation. So what is it? Like, I started to work in different innovation programs, external innovation, internal innovation, and one of the questions that I asked myself at the beginning is, what is it? What is innovation is about? So if you go on the internet and you search, you'll find endless definition. Like this one, something different that has an impact, or maybe more complex one about creating and capture value. So probably there's not a perfect one, but what it's easier is to spot innovation.
Water, humanity's greatest need and one of the world's biggest challenges. Freshwater resources remain scarce, and over 780 million people lack access to clean drinking water. WaterGen's patented technology taps into our planet's most abundant source of water, the air, and transforms it into a rich and renewable source of fresh drinking water. Air is drawn into the WaterGen atmospheric water generator. The air filter removes dust and dirt. Clean air is then directed through WaterGen's innovative genius technology and undergoes a heat exchange and cooling process. This brings the air to its dew point, the temperature where condensation occurs, and water is created.
One third of the population nowadays still doesn't have access to drinkable water. And with solutions like the one we've seen on the screen, they're able to create drinkable water out of air using just the same technology that ACs use. And they can use and create this water using solar energy. So imagine, that's an innovation. What you're seeing on the screen is not a futuristic video game. It's a company revolutionizing the mobility space. It's a vertical takeoff and landing vehicle that only uses electrical energy. Okay, let's do a raise your hand. Who recognizes this image? Most of you, Minority Report 2002, okay? 20 years ago. The good news is that there are solutions nowadays already recreating this in reality. So this is a company that just uses a wristband attached to a device, in this case an Apple Watch, and they're able to detect delicate finger movements and transform them into pressure on objects, in this case, the Apple Watch. However,
sometimes the word innovation is followed by a question mark, or to the word questionable, because not all of the innovation that was the good innovation, but we're going to see sometimes this kind of innovation.
Playing jazz.
Smoothie.
Making smoothie.
Calendar.
No meetings today. Remember.
And test.
At 9:30.
Fire off. Open door.
Door open.
And we're going to do one more.
Oh, yeah. Open door.
Wrong voice command.
Open door.
Wrong voice command.
Open door.
Repeat that.
Open door.
I didn't understand that.
Open door!
Play on the floor.
Sink on the floor.
Get on the floor! Open the door!
Open the door!
Open the door!
Error.
Hey, William. Good luck. Open door.
Open door!
This is just a funny ad, but you know how many of these innovations are present in the world, so like it's incredible. So just second poll, how many of you know this egg rock? One, two, three, it's less than minority.
Oh.
Yeah. So this is in the early 70s. Gary Dahl comes out in the US and he starts selling this box with the egg rocks and 70-page user manual for like 5 to 10 years. And you know what? He went away, he became a multimillionaire. Just selling this in the US, was selling Hag Rock. And this is, okay, it's innovation. He made it good because he became a millionaire, so it's lucky him, but I don't know how many now in those days will buy these Hag Rocks. Or in the US, going to Walmart, Cheetos lipstick. How many of you will, here in Italy, have the fancy lipstick and kiss a man or a girl with this one? I don't know, it's like, could be something that I will do it, but. And that, another one. Now in these days of super connection and the young people that is always in the phone with the phone, so you can plug a spoon or a fork and at least eat something without losing the eyes on the focus on your phone. So this is this innovation. Guys, we go ahead with innovation. Another one, this app 2014 came out and you was only sent yo as a text message or voice message to your friend. 3 million download. 3 million. Just something that is incredible. Or if you go ahead, this one, probably she bought because she's a cat lover, and when we were creating the presentation, she was, oh, let's wait, so I will check next day. This cat litter sent notification to the owner when the cat go in the box. You see? I know, I will check her phone the next day in the office.
No, I don't want it.
Yeah, yes, let's see, because I think that some notification come from the cat litter. And last one. J0, this company, raised 100 million. See? $100 million in like the few rounds with a lot of investors. This is also questionable innovation. So.
Okay, so we've seen big innovation, questionable ones, but we'll go back to what innovation is about. I believe that innovation doesn't have to be always about creating new things. Innovation, it's also about improving a little process or maybe changing something that our customers don't even see. And that's why I joined Atlassian, because it's concept of innovation. So I've been at Atlassian for a bit more than 1 year, and what I've been trying to gather is that why is innovation so good? Like, why is everybody innovating? So what we're gonna bring you today is a summary of what we believe are key aspects of innovation at Atlassian. We'll cover the culture and our innovation frameworks. So let's dig in about the culture. You can have the biggest innovation funding, the biggest innovation department, or the coolest incubator, but if you don't have a culture of innovation, if all your employees don't feel responsible and entitled for innovation, there's high chances that you won't succeed. So here we've built what we call the road to a culture of innovation, where you see like different milestones around it to achieve that culture of innovation. So the first one is about clear goals, giving a strategic direction to your employees. The second one is about building a diverse and inclusive workforce. The third one is having free-flowing information, then having autonomy, and having dedicated time to innovation. So let's go one by one. Clear goals. As I said, we need to give strategic directions to whoever wants to innovate. So let's take an example. It's a extreme one, but probably the greatest innovation that we've seen recently. We were talking before about COVID, and we've seen how we, the humanity, developed a vaccine in record time. So here, the cross-functional team that created the vaccine, they had a clear goal, create a vaccine. So that allowed them to work nonstop on creating novel ideas and develop this vaccine because they had a clear goal. I'm gonna go back. because I forgot to tell you our goals in Atlassian. So how do we set up goals in Atlassian? OKRs. I don't know if you're familiar with this structure of goals. They're calling objective key results. So how does it work? Every quarter, we have goals at a company level. And those goals are cascaded down to every team, which means that all the company goes towards the same direction. And if you want to innovate, it has to be tied up to these goals. Now, second one, diverse and inclusive workforce. I don't know how many of you here are managers, but we have a tendency of trying to hire people and try to have interpersonal connections among the people. If my teammates are friends, that's a good outcome. I'm not saying it's wrong, but that also has a risk. When you hire similar people and two cohesive teams, there's a risk that they all think the same. And even if they don't have the same ideas, there's a risk that they won't voice them up because they're going to be scared, you know, to make their friends unhappy. So that doesn't mean that we need teams fighting against each other, but we need to find a balance between personal connection and cognitive diversity. So we see many companies that hire based on cultural fit. What we do at Atlassian is hire based on values. So we have clear that we want people with different identities, backgrounds, skills, but they have to share the same values. We hire based on common values. So that's the baseline, to have diverse teams, but that they have a common safe space to share their ideas and ask their questions, because there's never dumb questions, and more when we're talking about innovation. The next one is free-flowing information. Transparency is key for innovation and in general at a company, because transparency gives trust to your employees, and trust increases engagement. So imagine, like, you're going at your companies, you're thinking about developing a new project, and you start like asking your colleagues, like, hey, can you point me to someone that developed this? Okay, talk to this person, you talk to this person, like, yeah, we did something 2 years ago, just send me your PPT so I can take a look, and this person says, yeah, actually, there was a person that actually is not in the company anymore that also did something, and you cannot access that document anymore. So what we do at Atlassian is to have a centralized database of information, which is Confluent. So you can go anytime, type whatever you want, and you'll find whatever has been done around a topic. This allows you to first, of course, know what has been done, to know if it worked, to know if it didn't, and also start your innovation project already with a baseline of information. The next one is autonomy. So we've said you have to give your teams clear goals, you need to give them access to information, you need to have diverse teams to make sure that you have different ideas, and that's it. Then you need to let them do their work however they want. It's proven that control doesn't have high-performing teams. You need to let them do and achieve their goals the way they want. And finally, dedicated time. Going back to the example of COVID, it's proven that people work better under constraints. Like when you have a tight deadline or something urgent to be delivered, teams work better. So at Atlassian, we give two constraints. The first one, it's the goals that we already talked about them. Everything you create has to be always aligned with the goals of the company. And the second one is time. We're going to talk about it later, but we have innovation timelines. We have our 24-hour hackathons and our innovation weeks to make sure everything is delivered during a short period of time. Why? As I said, because it's more efficient, and also to make sure that employees don't feel that their time to innovation is stepping in their day-to-day work. So this is the road to a culture of innovation. There's not one road. It's not perfect. Like, we'll continue improving it. But it's for sure some things that we've tested that it works to achieve that successful innovation. So it's not easy to get that innovation culture at a company level. But we encourage you, you know, to start testing ideas, think about how you're creating new processes, and think, like, do we have clear goals? Like, has everybody access to the information? Do we have the autonomy to do things however that we want? And little by little, things will start flowing, because that's it. Once you achieve that culture of innovation, the company starts becoming like a big lab where everybody's encouraged to bring new ideas, to test new things, and little by little pass that value to our customers. So once you achieve that culture, now you need to bring frameworks to make sure that everybody delivers.
Ready. So now we talk about a little bit about the structure. So going ahead with the principle that Raquel just showed us, in Atlassian we want to give to all of our employees the best channels, frameworks to unleash their ideas. So what we want to really do is that everyone in the company have the opportunity to come out and have an idea, crazy or not, technical or non-technical, that help to create maybe the next product that the customer will love to buy, or maybe to take or make Atlassian a better place to work. So it's not about only on product, but we are talking also on the work life in the office, in the procedure. So innovation is everywhere around us. It's not literally. So we want to share and give the opportunity to everyone to innovate. So we have two different frameworks. I go ahead with the first one. So ShipIt. ShipIt is our main innovation event that starts from the beginning when Atlassian was founded in 2002 in Sydney. So to be honest with you, ShipIt is not the real name that this initiative was born with, because it was called FedEx Day. And if you go on Google and search FedEx Day Atlassian, you will see a lot of information and nice stuff happening in the past. But the fun fact is that it was 2 or 3 years with the FedEx Day, Atlassian in Sydney got a call, okay, hey, FedEx calling. So what's wrong? So I think that we have a mistake, because FedEx Day from Atlassian are the first result in Google better than FedEx. It's okay. Okay, guys, so bad. It's completely fine. If you own us royalty, we can leave this and disagreement for us. Or either way, you have to change the name. I will change the name, because it was a little bit little and no sense fighting with FedEx. So it became ShipIt. So ShipIt, it happened 4 times a year, so 1 time every quarter, 24 hours. All of the employees had the opportunity to stop, create team, and innovate. Just create an idea. Whatever it is, like crazy, non-crazy, office, product, empowerment of some product. And the point that is, this event are supported and coached by VP, the two founders. So this is important, because it's not like initiative left from the employee. So everyone in the company is involved. We can, for example, go deep in some shipping project came out in the year. So the first one is, as you know, our main product is Jira. Jira started in 2002 as a tracker, and growing and go with have more customer, more issues. We arrived at a certain point that was slow. So one of the projects that the dev luckily came out, it was like, okay, we need to rebuild and make Jira faster. That can empower the search engine and the UE and UI, UX, and hopefully they want to ship it, and they have the time and the investment for make Jira faster. The second one is like better bulbs in the office. So why we need to have like this dark light in the office, and that is use a lot of energy. So we want to be more green with the lamp that was a LED lamp that consume less and that is a better view in the office. But it came out also to, okay, maybe we change the beer that we are offering at the Atlas Bar, because this one is not good. And that this is our kind of empowerment and improvement from ShipIt. But we also have mind-blowing product. Jira Service Management, as you know, is one of our projects. Our product right now that came from ShipIt. So the release 0 of ShipIt was called Viewport. So what happened? That some developers was talking with customers, talking internally, and then they saw that some team was using Jira software as a tracking system and a support system, as a ticketing system, changing some fields, changing some workflows, This will help them to handle ticket, but was not a ticketing system. So what they do? So they create a customer interface, they open more channel for open ticket, and they get some feature like SLAs, and this ticket, this feature based on the ticketing system. And you know what? Jira Service Desk is the most fast-growing product of Atlassian. It came from ShipIt, from an idea of employees, that it became one of the fast-growing products. No, it became the fast-growing product in Atlassian. And just for give you the last number, Jira Service Management last quarter had 500 million trial download. And it became from innovation in Atlassian. Just people that have an idea and now is making a lot of revenue for the company. But I don't know, we will have issue problems and we don't see the video, but we love to have fun. We work, but we love to have fun. DJ Kanban is another innovation that we had. So imagine to have your Kanban board in Jira and switch from issue to music. And then use your different state for mix the song. And this was one of the funniest innovation that in all of our event, in the, our team in Las Vegas, in our event all over the world, DJ Kanban is always with us and having fun at the end of the event.
A very cool experience, and actually it was a very nice way of collaborating with colleagues that you haven't met, like, and we created a sales product. Like, we were not tech people, but we detected a need and we were able to ship it in 24 hours, and now we're exploring like what's next, and probably what's next is going to be point A. So point A is our second innovation framework. It's a newer one. It was launched in 2020. And it's it could look like an incubator, but we say it's not an incubator. It's a framework because it's not something separate, isolated from all the department. It's a framework that we give to any employee that want to develop a new, and launch a new product. So you have steps, you have to be ambitious, you need to use our existing platform, you need to leverage on the Atlassian competitive advantage, and going through the different innovation steps, you must be able to deliver and launch your new product. So comparing other incubator frameworks that I've seen or incubation programs together with this one, I think there's one key part that it's different and makes it successful. So we've seen that it has an internal part, no? There's a process, employees apply, they need to be ready to fail because there's, let's be honest, like when you incubate something, the ratio of success, it's very low. But still, you go through the process, and that's something that all the incubation frameworks have. What is tricky is the external part, because sometimes there's a misalignment between what you're creating and your customers. It's hard to have your customer testing their products. It's hard to get insight from them to really evolve the project and the product towards what they want. And that's the part that I think Atlassian has nailed. Here, what you see on the website is point A. It started with five products, now there's another five, and they're available to customers. You can find them on different testing stages, from alpha to beta, but you can go and try them. And that's extremely valuable for us, because we're gathering insights as we evolve the products. So we said that we were going to talk about two pillars. Actually, we lied. There's a third one that Simone already briefly mentioned, that is the sponsorship. If you don't have the buy-in of your top management, of your founders and CEOs, innovation is always going to be isolated. And it's hard to get that, you know, like transversal innovation along the company. And that's why it works at Atlassian. As Simone said, our founders, they were the one creating ShipBits. They were the first one participating. Now they create their own awards, and they give time to their employees to innovate. And that's key of the success. So I'm going to finish saying what I said. This is not a perfect framework. We'll continue working on it, and you have to find your own. It's not always easy to get that transversal view, but we encourage you to find your way, look for those goals, find those like little moments to innovate together as a team, and little by little, things will improve. Thank you very much.
Oh, thanks. Thanks a lot. Is there any question? I do have one for you, though.
Okay.
Innovation is a word that dominates this industry, and like one of the most representative companies in that sector is probably Google. And I was curious to know, because lately there's been a lot of discussion around the dismissal of Stadia, the video game console, which brought up again the set of incentives they have within Google that I think is known as develop, promote, abandon, something like that. And that brings a lot of their products to life because they have incentives to launch, but then they have no incentives to maintain them. Okay. And so as it always happens, think, I don't know, Weave or Google Reader, there's probably a cemetery of abandoned Google products. Have you ever witnessed that in the kind of initiatives that you do?
I think that's why frameworks are key. You know, like probably in that framework you have a gap where, like, you know, as you said, there's incentives to launch it, but none to maintain it. Like, I don't know how exactly it works at Google, but for example, what we have explained on the framework of point A, you become your own team and business unit. You know, like, so you will have objectives that are tied to the company level. So why would you abandon it? I mean, unless KPIs and metrics are telling you that this is not succeeding and you need to let it go, which is fine. I mean, innovation is also about that. You have different stages. Your KPIs work until some point, and then you don't have the market fit or whatever, and you need to let it go, and that's also fine. I mean, probably with Google, they're more exposed also to fail and to success, so we can name many projects that succeeded, but we can name also many that didn't, but that's fine. So what you would need to see is, like, is it about the framework, you know, that they don't have the process, or is it just about success ratio that they had 10 that succeeded and 20 that failed? That's a good ratio, so it depends.
Probably they could get some insights from Atlassian.